IVM.
Hey everybody, welcome to another week on the IVM Podcast Network. I'd like to thank our sponsors, Paytm Money Upfront. Guys, we're heading into week two of the lockdown, and I'm sure it's been challenging for all of you, just as it's been for us. We're doing our best to make sure that we maintain our schedules, but beg your indulgence if we slip. In the meantime, if you're looking for more stuff to listen to, might I suggest you go dive into the archives? We've got over 6,000 episodes of content we've created over the last 5 years, and I'm sure there's something in there that you'd love listening to. Anyway, stay safe, and let me get you started with your show.
All the world's a stage, and all the men and women merely players. They have their exits and their entrances, and one man in his time plays many parts, his act being seven ages. As You Like It, where the speech belongs, and all the world's stage is a proverb that we've heard so many times over and over. Right now, all the world is just one big quarantine space. In times like these, while all of us are struggling to grapple on to reality, I still wanted to continue with the podcast, recording another episode via Zoom and kind of figuring out the technical challenges as we go. On today's episode, we have somebody who embodies the Shakespearean quote to her entire core, somebody whose whole world has been a stage. There is no platform that she hasn't touched so far in her whole acting, voiceover, and comedy career so far. Somebody who is also a host on the IVM Network, who hosts a podcast called Gol Gappa in Marathi. And she hosted me 2 weeks ago, which was a splendid experience. I realized over time in the past few episodes we've done, there's one very central aspect to the idea of English literature or literature in any language that we haven't covered so far. That is theatre. But what exactly is happening with theatre over time? Where is it going? When the third bell rings and the curtains are opened, you enter another world. But has that world stayed the same over time? How does one actor's personal experience also shape the theatrics of their own being? Joining me after this short break is somebody who you've seen on Tumhari Sulu, Beecham House, Pia Behrupia, Gadhedo, Mother Curry Channel Children, Stories in a Song, Foo by Foo, and so many other plays and films and TV shows and Girls Hostel if you followed it. This list is endless, just like all the love and support that this person has given to me and to endless other people in this industry. Joining me after this short break on Lit Nama is Trupti Khamkar.
This is the amazing story of something awesome. Once Chuck decided to start a podcast, and so he did. The end. Okay, that was a crappy story. But I've got some really cool stories over at my new show, The Origin of Things. On this podcast, I look at the stories of how brands came into being and sometimes evolved out of quite unexpected circumstances. And to make it really fun, I reveal the name of the brand and sometimes a category only at the very end. The show is 5 to 7 minutes per episode and perfect for trivia junkies and brand nerds, especially those with short attention spans. New episodes out every Wednesday on IVM Podcast app or website, or any podcast app or site that you happen to prefer. End of story, they lived happily ever after.
Hello Trupti, welcome to Lit Nama. Before I say anything, I want to put it up top that I'm a huge fan of you for multiple reasons. One of those very, very, very reasons being the fact that you were on Shakespeare's Globe performing.
Yes, I was.
Oh my God. Like, I've just read about it in books. I've stalked it on the internet. I have seen it, admired it. But how was it performing at the Globe?
Fantastic. It was amazing. Ekter, this is an English podcast.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. We can switch in Marathi a little.
This is what happens when a Gol Gappa host is talking to a Lit Nama host. So basically, it was the year where London had Olympics, they were hosting Olympics,
okay,
the game. And they decided that with Olympics, they wanted to extended to theater, and because it was 400 years of Shakespeare, and Shakespeare's written 37 plays, so they commissioned 37 different languages to come and perform.
Okay.
So Shakespeare Globe never lets you perform in any other language but Di Dai Dao wala Shakespeare in English.
Correct.
So the first time ever that they were commissioning different languages, and India being such diverse kind of country with so much cultures, we had two of our plays going there, like one in Gujarati and one in Hindi.
That is and,
Yeah, and when I heard of it, I was so kicked. I first went to Sunil Chanbag because I was working with him for Stories in a Song. And I said, he was doing the Gujarati version of All's Well That Ends Well. And I said, I want to be a part of this. Yeah. And he said, no, listen, I don't know if your Gujarati is good enough. I'm like, dude, listen, I have worked in Gujarati professional theater. You can't, like, I look Gujarati, I sound Gujarati, don't worry. He's like, no, I don't know. So he turned me down. Now, I had to get to Globe, you know, I had to do it.
Yeah.
So, I went and wrote to Atul Kumar, and he said that, Trupti, we are looking for singing actors. I said, dude, I am a singing actor. Listen to me. I'm telling you, I'm a trained singer. Like, I've been training to be a singer and an actor. So, Amoji was my trainer since 2000, and he's been training me for voice and speech for theater. And this was in 2011, so already so many years had gone by. So I said, yeah, I can sing. And that's how I went. And there were two people for my character. One was Neha Saraf. The other was me. We didn't know who's exactly going to London. And
oh,
fingers
God.
Were crossed and this and that. And then Amitosh, Neha's husband, came on board. And he wrote the character called Phool Singh. That's how she got Phool Singh. I got Maria. And I went to London.
That is so cool. Oh, God.
Yeah. And so when we were rehearsing in Kamshet, and they gave us the stage dimensions, and it was huge. Matlab, ispe to riksha leke jana padega. You know, it's that big. Yeah, matlab, hamari band bachcho ki, we were so scared. We were like, there are no mics. It's a huge stage. How are we going to do it? Yeah. But then we went there, and there was this one lady called Jude, I think her name was, and very old, like she was 70-ish. But she was so cool. She took us around and then she told us these are some sweet spots on the stage. So there are literally some, it's made in a way that even if you whisper from one point, everybody, like 1,200 people in your audience, can hear you loud and clear when you whisper. Yeah, it's insane. It is, I think, maine toh bahut punya kiya hai. Like, I've done so much
good. Shakespeare's Globe is like every literature nerd's wet dream. Like to
oh my God,
go to Globe and oh God, and another.
I'm also glad about this. Wait, I'm gonna not stop here. But then the next year, Globe also invited the Gujarati play one more time for a week long run.
Okay.
And one of Sunil's assistant director, who used to play like a small role, she used to play one of the mothers, and she would speak Burmese and Gujarati, like three lines each. So he said, will you want to come with me? And you will have to do production and do the little bit of that character. I said, sure. So I went and I did a week-long run at the Shakespeare's Globe.
Wait. You went there twice. You performed there for a whole week.
I went there twice. Yes.
Oh my
I performed
God.
For a whole week. And it's a cheap thrill, okay? So one day, because I had this one dressing table which had Trupti Khamkar written on it. And one day, just for kicks, I left my gold ring. I left it on the table. And the next day I came and my gold ring was right there. Nobody moved it. It was my table. Can you believe it? I was so kicked. And then Judy Dench came to watch us. And oh my God.
Oh
yeah.
My God.
So Judy Dench came to watch us and I was doing production. So I was packing my stuff and people had gone out already to have a glass of wine with her. And when I went up and these production people at the Globe knew me because I'd come there the year before as well. They're like, have you met them? Have you met her? Have you met her? So jab tak Judy Dame Judy Dench had become Judy Bane.
Yeah.
Okay, for the good Jews. So she was Judy Bane ko dekha kya? Judy Bane ko dekha kya? So I went to meet Dame Judy Bane. And then, like, this is the biggest compliment of my life. It goes to the grave with me. She said, you are the best actor of the team because the actor who knows where every prop goes is one of the best actors of the team. And I think this is it. Like, no Filmfare, no Oscar, nothing, no shit can beat this compliment because I want to be like her. Like, I want to be Judy Dench one given point of time in my life, someday.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I'll call you Trupti Bane. Dame Trupti Bane. That sounds great.
No, but it was an experience of a lifetime. So technically, I'm the only actor in the world who's performed in Hindi, Marathi, no, Hindi, Burmese and Gujarati on the Shakespeare's Globe Theatre. So, yeah, that's enough of bragging from me. Let's get to your show.
Oh, my God. No, listen, this is a complete brag fest today because I have known. It's so surprising because you think that you know people, but then all of these fun things about them, and you're just like, have I ever known this person truly? Like, it is baffling because I remember when I was on Golgappa and we were talking about literature. And you were like, oh, I don't read, but I have just read all of Shakespeare's plays in the original language just for kicks.
Yeah, because he's such a beautiful writer. What do you do of him? You know, see, the thing is that Shakespeare, if you actually go to like the Thee Thy Thou version of the real original version of Shakespeare, I doubt you will put that thing down. You know, also because I'm somebody who's a very bad reader. If I put it down, I have to start from zero. So I'd be like, nahi, mere ko maza aa raha hai. So let me just go through and just finish it. So I would actually go to the BCL because I was doing my bachelor's in management. We didn't have textbooks, so we had to go to BCL to kind of get notes. And my team would be doing the notes ka kaam research. And I would be in this one corner taking out Shakespeare, reading the whole thing, going back home.
But it is so crazy. That's when I found out, you told me about your dyslexia and you still managed to read the Thee Thy Thou language because people who are put in literature courses and classrooms still struggle to pick up the where the them becomes then and all of those little tricky bits. And it's just astounding how much demanding theatre is also in that sense, right? Because people think that theatre is just acting. It's just what you know, the end product. But you put in so many years. How was your story of getting into theatre in the first place?
I have answered this question too many times. Probably your listeners must have listened to it like 20 times at least. Okay. But I have come to a conclusion where it all came from vengeance because I was a fat child and nobody ever let me go on because I wouldn't fit into the bahari ka kapda. So I went like we also spoke in Golgappa that we spoke basically Pragati Zali that I went to Gokhale College because I was entitled to speak great English.
I think we should keep that story a secret for people to know. They should go and watch our episode. Trupti and I also did this very fun thing called Mulgi Shikli Pragati Zali together. It's in Marathi with a lot of subtitles to it in English, which we both stay up all night breaking our heads over. So this story about how Trupti and why Trupti went to Gokhale College is a part of the second episode about short skirts. Yeah. Which is a very, very delightful episode to even record and listen to. So, you would say.
Yeah. So, I mean, great plug-in, Laxmi. I like it. So that's... I had a teacher who would teach Marathi and she saw me and she said, why don't you do theatre? And I said, me? She said, yeah. And that's how it just started. And the first year I did my Marathi play where I was one of the 40 people in the wall standing there and I would rehearse every day to not blink my eyes for 40 minutes. Okay. So that was my commitment to theatre. Then I went to the 12th grade and I did a Gujarati and a Hindi and a Marathi play. And 12 days before my exam, I was doing a play in Pune. So my parents really lost their shit. They're like, listen, babe, you are not going to this college again. So they found out a course which is called Bachelor's of Management. Okay. They found out a college where there was no theatre, which was Bhavan's College. And so I went into Bhavan's College and I got my admission there. And because BMS was 40-60, so you had to do work, do project work and writing. And you had to do 12 subjects a year. It was semester-based. So you change subjects every 6 months.
Every 7,
so it was crazy. Yeah. So my parents are like, abhi toh padhai karegi, ab toh kuch nahi natak vatak. But then luck had it and then that college started with, like on my what, freshers party, I went and asked somebody, don't you have theatre? They said, yes, we do. We're starting theatre this year. That's how I got on. The next year, Nirmal Pandey, my director was working with Nirmal Pandey, so he called me in for that. So I did Andhayuk and at the age of 18, I did my first big character, which was Gandhari from Andhayuk. And I think that was it. Like we rehearsed for 9 months for that play and a lot of shit went crazy. It hit the fan. But then I think that's where it all came together for me, that what my commitment means for theatre and how much I love it and how much I want to be only on theatre and be my audience, have them right there eating out of my hands, because that's another feeling to have. No media, no online social media can give you that feeling where your audience is right there. So I think, that's my first love and will always be. So that's how theatre started. And then there was no looking back. Like, I did my graduation, then I did my master's in theatre. Oh, this you have to listen.
Yeah.
My parents lost their shit again, okay? So I did my CFA while I was doing my BMS. So itna hi padhai nahi, bahut padhai kiya maine.
Yeah.
And they are like, now MBA. So I said, listen, now I've learned a lot. I have never been in my class. So I've learned I've studied all the textbooks, everything I've studied. Yeah. Now I only need a degree of master's, okay, if it's management. So I said, I will do an IIM. I'll go to an IIM and I will do a combination of finance and HR. And then my plan was ki uske baad, just do PhD in theater in HR.
Oh, that's
great. So that was the plan.
Yeah.
And I was like, I'll write my CAT, but if I don't get through any IIM, then I will also write my entrance for NSD.
Okay.
Again, luck would have it. University of Mumbai came with the first batch of masters in
school.
Yeah. And my CAT paper leaked. So by the time the re-exam happened, I had studied hard. I woke up every morning at 4. Yeah. I did my mock test. I did all of it. Like, I really worked hard for it. Not that I didn't want to do it. Yeah. But then because I got my master's ka admission, then there was no point wasting money in doing master's in management where I was not even going to be happy. So that's how it became. And then once you get the master's degree, then who's going to stop?
Yeah.
So, well, I was also blessed with a lot of other things, like a good voice. So I did voicing, I did this, that, the other. But yeah, I cannot sustain. How much did I talk?
No, that's okay. You know, one of the very interesting things I've noticed about you. So for the listeners who do not know Trupti, I'm very, very shocked. But apart from that, you've done theater, you've acted in films, you've been on every media platform that you can possibly imagine in the country right now. You've done, you've been on Foo by Foo as well, which is like, like Marathi Great Indian After Challenge. You've done Marathi.
Yeah, but you know what? Can I tell you a little anecdote about Foo by Foo? So when Foo by Foo was happening, I would be, if you go back and you see Foo by Foo episodes, I don't look who I am usually. I had different get-ups. And so much so that my dear friend Siddharth Jadhav, who came on the show once, did not recognize me. So what would happen is they knew me as Trupti Khamkar. Like, a lot of Maharashtrians know me by my name, but they cannot put the face to it because it looks so different. So there's one time when I was coming from Pune and I was so fried that there was no AC bus. I said, okay, I'll go in the Shivneri 2x2. So I went in and I was sitting there next to a lady. She had a big bag. So I said, is the seat taken? She said, no. So I sat next to her. And my friend came outside near the window and said, hey, Truptya, you want a bottle of water? And this bhai who was trying to figure out where has she seen me, she's like, are you Trupti Khamkar? And I said, yes. Should I get out of the bus? She's like, no, I'll not trouble you, but I'm a big fan. I said, thank you. And that was it. And I went off. I went put my glares on and I went off to sleep. I'm like, I'm not having any more conversation on this. Because 4 hours of, ani kai karta, kiti chhan dista, kiti funny ahat. Like, I've got things like, you are mad on screen, how are you so sane?
Oh God.
Like, what do you even mean? I am mad on screen and I look sane in real life. I mean, I don't get it. So
super interesting, right? Because you have a podcast of your own. You're on YouTube now. You post videos actively. You are on everyone's Instagram feed because you're so out there with your honesty, which is one thing that seeps through everything that you're doing. Don't laugh, it's true. It's just one thing I've observed about you. I don't know if this comes from theater or the practice of theater, that you are very particular about your characters, like the way you study them, the way you portray them. I've seen you kind of go into the process of how do you become a character, even if it is a pinky wearing a pink wig and just like talking in a very shrill pitched voice to somebody who is like doing a proper Shakespeare Globe level work. Do you feel like the study of character kind of makes theatre what it is and separates it from all the other forms, or do you think it exists everywhere?
No, sorry, what's the last line? Does my character?
So, does the study of character that you've done, for example, for your theatric productions, which is more detailed in theatre, right? Because in theatre, you've given your description of how a character is supposed to be imagined by the writer whose play you're probably working on. But is this the same with, say, film, with YouTube, with everything else? Have you taken that idea of learning character everywhere, or is it different for every medium?
Yeah, it definitely kind of, I think it's now so inbuilt in me that I don't really have to work hard. But the point is that unless you have like a sarpair to the character, it doesn't become interesting.
Yeah.
You know, like I'm still trying to dig with Pinky, what Pinky thinks, what is her idea, what is her background, where does she come from, where does she earn the money, what makes her sad. Like this is how I actually work on my character, is what makes my character sad. Because that's how you build on that individual. And I mean, I believe that if I'm doing something, I do it 100%. I don't want to do it half-baked.
Correct.
You know? So, I will not have fun unless, like, there's another character which I'm building on, which I go on TikTok to do. Because I think TikTok is a shitty place. Did I just say that? But yeah, so there's this one girl who goes, Baya, meko idhar se udhar jani hai, please, Baya. Yeah. So it started with like chilling with a friend. I said, Baya, aage jaake chod do humko types. But so then he said, why don't you do it? So I said, okay. Then I started thinking, what's her name? So I thought her name was Katyayani. And now now her thing is called Crisis Katyayani, because Katyayani is going through crisis all the time. Like, why is everybody looking at me? Like, I've come out for bare necessities. You know, I need my chocolate, Baya. I can't live without it. How do you expect to be in a lockdown without eating a chocolate, Baya? So now Katyayani has become like a Crisis Katyayani, you know? So somewhere now I'm making that character. So you either build it from nothing, or you have a character, which is, on the other hand, my whole theater play production happens with a character is given to you and you start digging in.
Yeah.
So yeah, but your answer to your question is yes, I cannot not have a character before I can make something out of it. It has to have some sarpair, some logic.
So another thing I always wonder is, because you're on so many different mediums, like right from like a theater stage to a TikTok, that's a brilliant spectrum of mediums to kind of go through. Have you seen, what are the kind of changes that you've seen in the idea of storytelling that happens? For example, when you're doing a crisis Katyayani to somebody who's playing a very proper, say, a Gandhari, like we spoke about, is the story still the same being repackaged to different mediums, or has the story really changed over time? What do you think?
The story does change. The story changes because the levels in the story change.
Correct.
You know, it's the type of the story. It could be a short story to a big long story format, and then the conflicts change.
Correct.
You know, so there are times when there is only one setup, one punchline kind of story, a very small joke. Whereas if there is a Andhayog kind of a script where the story is like has so many characters, so many parallels running. So definitely it also changes accordingly, because even in theater, the story changes from, as opposed to when you make a film of it.
Yeah.
Because the medium changes, the way the audience is going to look at it changes. So there's a lot, there are different patterns of a story. And it definitely is different from every story is different. I think even like if you take one story and you try putting it in two different mediums, the story differs.
Right.
It doesn't stay the same. So, yeah.
So, I've been, okay, this might be very, very reductive understanding, but every third quote-unquote actor I've met in my life, not in my life, in just Andheri, every 100 meters, you'll meet a new person. But, you know, you did talk about this entire detail of theater and method acting, and this one time it was a very funny interaction, because this one person started talking about method acting and I brought up Stanislavski's name and he's like, who's that? And I'm like, if you're talking about method acting, he is the one who originated the idea about Stanislavski's methods, of which we do it now. Maybe you as a master's in theater, or me as a master's in literature, we might know this background behind it. But do you feel that the way people are looking at theater has changed over time? Do people now use theater as a stepping stone to kind of make serious characters out of themselves? Or are they really practicing theater in the way it was taught and trained to be?
I don't know. I think it's diluted now as opposed to what it used to be. It's become more flashy and flowery, like auto method, blah, blah, blah. It's not just Stanislavski. There are different methods of acting.
Correct.
There is a Bertolt-Brecht method of acting. There is a grotesque method of acting. There is Stanislavski method of acting. There is, I just keep forgetting names.
Yeah.
So many methods of acting, and there is pre-expressionism method of acting. There is psychophysical method of acting. So, of course, over the period of time, people who are sincerely working towards making theater good have been discovering these methods, have been bringing it back to the practice floor. But some years ago, where I was really disappointed in people where they say theater is my passion, but you see that they are only doing it because they want to go to an audition room and say, I'm a theater person.
Exactly.
Which is, I don't know really, because the time is changing, you know, so you can't, I cannot say, hamare zamane mein to aise hota tha. It's just stupid to say that. But right now, this is the call of time, I believe, that people are just quickly like jumping like butterflies from this to that to that to that, and picking up whatever little they can and just not spending a lot of time on it. But I just hope that people really practice only theater. Yeah. Like, I wish if theater could pay my bills, I would never come on an Instagram. I would never go to a TikTok. I would, unfortunate, but then I wouldn't make content. But I think theater is something that has so much to do, so much to dig in, that it's somewhere kind of diluting. It's fizzling out is what I feel.
Yeah.
And because I have traveled a lot, I can tell that India is kind of slipping a bit. We need to train our audience to watch good theater. We cannot just give them substandard content, you know?
Correct.
Yeah, tell me what?
I was just saying that how theater reception also is a skill that needs to be kind of not taught in like textbooks, but also kind of culturally built, right? Because now when you go to theaters to actually watch plays, your first announcement has to be that, oh, switch off your mobile phones. The point being, why do you have to say that? There's a certain, it might sound very elitist, but there's a certain decorum to the room when you're entering a theater space. It doesn't need to be told to you to not munch on something or to not talk in the middle of a performance. Do you feel like the cinema culture has kind of corrupted the theater culture in a certain sense?
I don't think the cinema, I think the ghar pe baith ke social media and the internet has corrupted the even cinema, man. You cannot be going crum over the popcorn when I am watching A Quiet Place.
Correct.
You know, like something which really needs that silence. And there used to be a time where people would actually go to theater to watch a film or watch a play with great commitment and love. But now it's kind of like, even with Prithvi first, it would start on time, like dot 9 o'clock, the show will start at 9. Now it starts at 9:05, you know, we've kind of loosened it up for people. Good, wow, or good for audience, good for actors to have the audience come in. But why? What happened to the discipline, you know? And I think it's about us, it's about, the onus is on us artists to kind of make it clear and draw that line and say, no, we're going to be strict about this. Is how the culture will build. And everybody's just, they've spoiled themselves by sitting at home. Like you say, play. Like Pia Bhairupia is on Z5 now, you know?
Oh, okay.
I don't like that version of the short version of Pia Bhairupia, but people who couldn't get tickets will watch that version, you know?
Correct. Yeah.
And they'll pause it, and then they'll go to the loo, and they'll pause it and get a drink, and pause it and go eat. So then that, the whole experience of watching that thing has gone out of the window.
Yeah.
So, I think somewhere the social media has fucked us.
I really, really want to come back to a lot of how the streaming game has kind of changed how we look at theater, but I think it's time for a really short break. So, I mean,
okay.
Shamelessly, if people want to go get their drinks or go to the loo, this is the time, not later. So, join us right after this short break. There won't be any Tisri Ghanta for the very, very typical Marathi theater aficionados who live by that word. So, yeah, here's your short break.
Hi, I'm Satyajit.
Hi, I'm Racheta.
We are from the Open Library Project and we host a podcast called Paperback.
Paperback is a podcast where we engage with stalwarts and experts from various industries, suggesting non-fiction titles that contributed to their journey in a big way.
We've had guests like Anjali Rana, Dr. Marcus Rani, Dr. Swati Lodha, Ambi Parmeswaran, Apurva Damani, and many more on our show Paperback. Find new episodes every Wednesday on IVM Podcast app, website, or wherever you listen to podcasts.
Okay, welcome after this short-ish break. And I'm going to pick up. Wow. I was thinking of Bertolt Brecht for some reason. Like, I love Brecht, but like...
I love him
Brecht,
too.
But building Brecht on theater is a very difficult task, right? Or are we just reading too much?
No, I think I have done two Brechtian shows.
Okay.
One was Rise and Fall of City of Mohani.
Okay.
And the other was Mother Courage and Her Children.
Oh, and, yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So I played Begbig in Mahoney and I played Uwit in Mother Courage.
Mm.
And I think Uwit was one of my very dear, one of my favorites. So much so that her Indian version name, which was Ibni, which I found, yeah. I have inked it on my body because I really connect with Ibni. So... So actually, the thing was QTP, Kosar Thakur Padam C's company, QTP, they were doing a version of Mother Courage for what's Adyam. And they had this huge ass audition where some 500 people auditioned. And I went there for an audition. And of course, I did Gandhari Ka Shaap. And he was like, oh, so cliche. And then I sang a song from Mahoni.
Okay.
Rise and Fall of City of Mahoney. And that's when he knew that this is Uwit for us. Because yeah. Then I had a cabaret song in Madhu Courage, which I used to sing.
Yeah.
And basically, they auditioned me and I got... And when I sang that song, cabaret ka version for my audition, they knew and I knew that this is Ibni. So, as in, this is Uwit. And then he called me to the office and he said, listen, I want you to play Uwit and can you find... and Indian sounding, Persian sounding name for her, starting with I. So I went home and I was talking to my friend Adar and he said, let's find the name. So Ibni in Urdu means desire.
Okay.
So I said, hey, what a lovely name for this girl who's playing prostitute in the play. And I said, Ibni, and he also liked it. And then we went on floor and the first time the rehearsal started, Arundhati Nag, who also played Mother Courage in that play, she said, Ibni in Kannada means dewdrops.
Oh.
And I'm a half Kannadiga. My nani is a Kannadiga. So, and I love my nani. So, so I said, oh, then I love this name. And then there was a time when I was really upset. And after the rehearsal got over at 5 in the evening, I drove to Pune, got Ibni in Kannada written on my body, inked it, and came back. And next morning, 6:30, I was in the rehearsal showing people I inked myself. So, yeah, Brecht is one of my favorites that I've done too. Shows already, so I don't think it's difficult. Brecht is so human. Brecht is so layman, just like Shakespeare.
So I feel like I think of Brecht in a very different way because I've read more of his existential plays as part of my syllabus. So like the Endgame and everything, and you're just like, and okay, wait, I'm mixing Brecht and Beckett. Endgame is
Beckett is also one of my favorites.
I wanted to talk to you about Beckett, and I was like, how did I start with Brecht? I'm sorry, guys. It's Beckett.
I've also done Beckett. I've done two, Godot, Waiting for Godot.
You've done Waiting for Godot. Oh my God. It's
Waiting for Godot, Act 1 for Children.
Oh, damn.
Children's Festival, and everybody had a question in mind, ki kya, how. And also, Beckett was somebody who believed that women should not be a part of the play.
Yeah.
And I used to play Estragon. And then I moved on to play Pozzo as well. But yeah, Estragon is one of my favorites. But again, when we did it for children, and then we had our shows at Prithvi and at Kala Kendra, and children would come backstage and I would ask them, like, did you understand? They say, yeah, it's easy. I'm like, how? It's like how I wait for my mama to come pick me up from my crèche, and then how I wait for my exams to get over, and how I wait for my dada to give me chocolate, and how so they just got it.
Yeah. It is so surprising. Children's brains are so weird. What do you think is existential theory and nihilism? And they're just like, oh, it's just waiting. It's as it's like not in the title. Guys, it's in the title. Yeah. What are you thinking?
He thinks he's so bored that he thinks he wants to kill himself. But he thinks if I kill myself, then I will not meet Godo, who's coming. So he waits.
Yeah, that's it.
It's as simple as that.
God,
why are we making it so complicated? Also, if you know the story of Godo, how it actually became famous, do you know the story?
No.
Oh, you don't? Okay, so when Beckett wrote Godo, it was one of the baddest plays ever. People are like, this, and nobody gets it.
Yeah.
What is this? So what? Now what? When? Who? One rope? I know. Is it Thursday? No, it's Friday. What is this play? And theater has had its own luck like that. Like, people don't want to watch it. Then you kind of get a show somewhere. So they happen to get a show in a prison where all the people in it, the inmates, were sentenced to death.
Okay.
So they knew when they're going to die. They knew the date of their death. And this show happened there, and it made complete sense to them. Because it is waiting for Godo. And that's how it became a classic. Because it became a super hit in that space. Because everybody who was actually waiting for Godo to come. And Godo never comes, you know. So, I think that's how it became a classic. And it's very dear to me. Endgame is amazing.
You just have my heart at this moment. Those are my top two Beckett plays. Because that was when Endgame was taught. So both of them have very brilliant memories attached to it. Waiting for Godot was one of the last things we studied in our TY literature classroom, where our professor used to ask us to read out, like actually enact those characters. So I used to be Vladimir, and one of my dearest friends, she used to be Estragon. To a point, we used to read it that in the class, everybody actually referred to us as Vladimir and Estragon. Because we used to always hang out together, go someplace together, come back to class together, fight and do everything exactly like. Our relationship became more and more like how Beckett would do it. I actually wrote her a farewell poem when she moved to Chennai for her master's that actually is called Waiting for Godo. And Endgame was the first thing I studied when I got into my master's course. So I was like a Beckett graduate. I was like, oh, Beckett. I know everything about Beckett. And then you read Endgame and you realize this man's brain is this very, very, very weird place to be in. Because this entire set design for Endgame, the way it is spoken about,
the windows and the drums,
And my professor just came and she was like, oh, this just might be a skull. They might be existing inside a skull. The two windows are the crevices for your eyes. And we were like, can you not spook us out, please? Because it's just...
Yeah.
Beckett is...
But that's the thing. You can interpret Beckett in whatever crazy way you want. You know, you can just go crazy as much as you want. Because there's so much space for it.
It is
why probably children understand more, because they have no borders it's and ideas. Boundaries to
put up.
Hey, it's a skull.
I like how they have... Yeah, you said something so prominent. There was one of these articles that I was reading which spoke about how if you really want to enjoy literature or a philosophical idea, you need to look at it as children look at it. Because then you will understand better, because you leave around all your fixed ideas of what comes from where and you look at it in a very pure sense. And that just makes so much sense. And it's surprising how Beckett is so interpretative, because Beckett has so little to interpret if you actually figuratively look at the play. I mean, there are
simple.
One set of characters, one set of props in a blank space. And he's just like, do whatever you want to do with it. Oh God.
Yeah.
This has just become a Beckett fangirling session.
What do you have to say about Ionesco?
Ma'am, you're just killing me here. What is this? Oh God, Ionesco.
If you're gonna talk of absurdity, then Ionesco is like the bap of
absurd plays. Yeah.
Like the bald sopranos, I cannot crack that deal even today. Also, I came across bald sopranos because I was going through some Marathi books in my library, and there was a book called Takkal Padleli Sundari, and I pulled it out because it was just intriguing. I'm like, what is Takkal Padleli Sundari? And then I realized that this is a translation of the bald sopranos.
Takkal Padleli Sundari is how I will describe that work henceforth.
And Takkal Padleli Sundari has, the Marathi version was so thick. They logo Dombivli la rahatat.
Hey, hello, excuse me, really?
Yeah. They say we eat methi chi bhaji because we live in Dombivli or something absurd as that. But the name kind of triggered something for me, and that's how I got introduced to Ionesco.
I feel very represented right now since I stay in Dombivli. I will make Methi Chi Bhaji, take a photo and tag it.
See, I'm not very sure about Methi Chi Bhaji, but yeah, but just
I'll check out. Absurd plays. These are so absurd because everything today is sort of an absurd play. The kind of world we're living in seems like something a Beckett would 100% write about. Like, he would think in a moment like these where we're all trapped inside our houses, in the age when we were all at a peak of our productivity, thinking that our life only leads around one moment of victory to another, one piece of work to another. And he's just like, oh, y'all are trapped at home. This is a great play idea. Let me write about how people went mad because they were trapped inside a room. And it's just so absurd. But also,
talking of this, the other day, we were doing this Zoom chat or something with my team of Mohani.
Okay.
Okay, and in Rise and Fall of City of Mohani, there's this one scene where we would take a break where the hurricane comes in. And after that, when everybody's sitting on the wall and then this Jimmy Gallagher kind of does a party out of it and he says, ki hum gaayenge, naachenge, maze karenge.
Yeah.
And our version of the play would start, the interval, post-interval scene was that everybody's sitting and they sing, ab hum gaye kaam se. So basically, it's about Moth Samne Khadi Hai Hamare, Moth Samne Khadi Hai Hamare. So there was a song about how the death is right in front, and we were all laughing and singing, and I was like, you know what, like, this is so real. Like, if you really go to the seriousness of this pandemic that we are in, you step out and you are dead.
Yeah.
Like, if you get it, you're dead and you don't get to see your family. It's really very dark and crazy. And it was like, I was like, agar meko marne ka hai, I want this Zoom video going where people are laughing and singing songs from Mohani. And then I messaged my director. I'm like, dude, this is act two, scene one of Mohani.
I'm just surprised because the amount of literature you can think of during... Yeah. That talks about situations like these. It's so unnerving. All these absurdist writers already thought about all of this. They have worked.
Yeah, because human life has been there since a real long time. And shit has been happening forever. So, yeah.
No, but also there is a very different counter absurdist movement that's coming up where people are kind of looking inward now. Is something that I feel Beckett tried hinting at, that and outside everything is so bleak that you cannot do anything about it. You turn inward and you turn quote-unquote philosophical. Yeah. That's what happens with Podzo and Lucky and Vladimir and Esteban, because they keep thinking of all of these amazing philosophical things to do, and they think about time and endlessness. And in a way, we have our own absurd ways of dealing with it, right? Like, you see all of these trends that are going viral. Like, it is so, so absurd. Is that you're just like, oh, if you go outside, you die. So wait, let me just go and make some coffee instead. Which is mocked, but at the same time, it's a great coping mechanism. Because yeah. I think of, look at all of these, like all these challenges. Berasari challenge, childhood photo challenge, all the other bizarre things that have shown up. You look at them and you think about, this is probably how Vladimir and Estragon would have dealt with it if they had internet back in the day.
Yeah.
and a coffee maker, of course. Because otherwise, how would they make that dalgona?
Do you have a spoon? Oh no, remind me to get a spoon tomorrow because we want to make dalgona coffee.
We should write our own version of a nice, like, Beckett analysis of the pandemic. It would go viral. Sure. I'm not even kidding you. But that being said, you've been writing other things these days. So for people who know, don't know, who follow, don't follow actor Trupti online, apart from the amazing acting, voiceover and everything else that she does, she's also been trying her hand at poetry. And she is on board with NaPoRiMo. For the listeners who don't know what NaPoRiMo is, National Poetry Writing Month, NaPoRiMo, is an activity that has been on at least, I think it traces back a decade, if I'm not wrong. I've been around for the last 4 or 5 years since it's been happening. It's something that people are doing all of April. They write one poem each day. The goal is to not write an amazing poem at the end of every day. The goal is to write something, put it out there, and kind of work on your own skill set. Because you set a routine of writing a poem. And the other day, Trupti and I were talking about it, about this whole excitement of writing one poem a day. It comes beautifully in time with quarantine. So all of us are at home. But it kind of changes the way you look at the world, because now you're looking at the whole world around you in metaphors, in possible images that you can use in your poem. Yeah. You can talk about, you are thinking about your past, your future, and you try to pick up all of these poetic things. So how has your NaPoRiMo experience been so far?
So basically, it started because of the lockdown. Because I'm more of a metaphorical person than, like, I'll always talk in analogies more than just facts in your face. So it started from there. So lockdown, I had to vent out something that I wanted to. And then I realized that there was, I think a couple of months ago, you told me about NaPoRiMo. And I said, oh, then this is a perfect timing to even start doing that. So technically, because of that hashtag that you asked me to use, now my thought has started changing a little from just quarantine and lockdown to whatever life is giving me. So I kind of, like I play with my thoughts, because morning page is another thing that I do every morning where I talk about what I'm feeling this morning. And it kind of, by like after now we finish this call, I will sit for tonight's poetry to just kind of pin down things and put them in place. But it's fantastic because I like metaphor and it's just so therapeutic. It's better than going out and doing a sari challenge.
You go in also because, and you drape your
You go further in.
You go inward sari
But there are, I realize that there are so many things that you've not really tapped, which you kind of stumble upon when you're writing a poetry.
Correct,
Which could be 5 lines, which could be 20, which could be as... And then I've realized that how I've started to kind of concise it and make it precise. Like not go... just flow and make 5 pages of a poem. Just make maybe four lines and 2 paras. Or just try and bring everything that you want to say in that one little space.
Yeah.
And less is more and more is less wala calculation. But I think I have to thank you for introducing me to this amazing thing
so much fun.
Called NaPoRiMo. Because I don't know if people are reading or not, but I'm making it.
I have a very stupid question now. It's a very, very stupid question even when I'm thinking about it. Is theater to poetry, what do you feel has literature done for you as a person, for your story as Trupti Khamkar? Because you've been on so many mediums. You've been on so many different things. How does it shape the larger? Like, it's a very philosophically stupid question. But how does it shape the larger idea of who Trupti is and how do we know her?
Whoa, that was a very important silly question, I must say. I think, you know, what I do, how Trupti Khamkar is shaped is basically, she's not somebody who really kind of, she gives in 100%. Then she soaks it in and then she unlearns. And then she tries to make her own. Like, I know people think that I'm a comedian and I'm very funny and I have great timing. But I enjoy doing serious characters more. I enjoy doing something that is more subtle. I enjoy it when I don't have a line in a scene where I have to just sit and react and intensely react and steal the show. Again, as a human being also, I'm very metaphorical. So poetry is something that really calls me. And I love Khalil Gibran. Room is my space, you know. So these are the people who really influenced me in a way. And yeah, I think everything has really contributed to my being. It could be what you wrote. It could be what... So I just keep choosing and picking and getting the flavor of it into my space and then just kind of pouring whatever is real and true. I don't think of how it will be judged and how it will look outside. It could look whatever. So yeah, that's how Trupti is.
Wow, just got so philosophical.
You asked a silly question. I had to give you a philosophical answer to it.
No, but it's just so amusing. We went from Brecht to Beckett. No, we started from Shakespeare. Then we went to Brecht. Mm-hmm. Then we went to Beckett. In between, somebody went to Stanislavski. And now we're back to you, which is a great segue.
You forgot Ionesco.
I forgot. What was the name of the book? I forgot. Ball Soprano. Taklea what?
Takkal Padleli Sundari.
Takkal Padleli Sundari. I have written this down in my notes now. Takkal Padleli Sundari is the next thing I am going to read. I hope I find a copy online. But yes, from there, this is a great segue to your poetry. I would really, really enjoy if you would want to read a piece out for us, maybe.
Yeah, see, I am an artist who, you give me a chance, I will hog the show. So the minute, I'm not going to say, oh my God, I don't know if my poetry really works. It works, fuckers.
Yeah.
So I've written quite a few now. I've written, I think, 7 to 8 of them. But two of them are really, really close to me. And I shall read them out. Or perfect. Maybe three, I don't know.
Go for it.
Yeah, let me just hunt for it first. Because I opened it and there you go. So this is what I wrote on the 29th of March. Life has got its own plans. Your strategy won't do. Just let go of that to-do list and find a new you. I fight the unbeatable. I punch, I push and scream. Why would you do this mean thing? Why would you spoil my dream? I dream of climbing mountains, of going to the sea. I dream of doing crazy things in pursuit of finding me. But life has got its own plans. Your strategy won't do. All you can do is surrender and find a new you. So this was what I wrote on the 29th of March.
That is so cool.
And there was one that I wrote. I wrote one when I stepped out to get some supplies. And it was really, it was not a great feeling to see my city so dead and so, like, I could smell some strong, tikha smell in the air, you know. It was not fun. It was not freedom. So this is what I wrote on that day, on the 3rd of April.
Okay.
I stepped out today and I thought I'd be free. Had errands to run, I went on a spree. That taste was no freedom. It felt more like guilt. It smelt of the war with the monster we've built. So, yeah, this was a quick chotu what I felt. And there was this... Oh, this is one of my very dear poems that I wrote. And this is dedicated to my Ajji, my nani, because she added a lot of value to my life. Are you there?
Yeah, I'm right here. I'm listening to you.
Okay, so this is this I wrote for my nanny.
Okay.
Because, So it goes like this. When I was young, my grandma said, look at the good in the bad instead. So I'm finding my time, sorting my head, keeping off the rat race to earn my bread. And when the day ends, I lay peacefully in bed and remember the things my grandma said. So, yeah.
So nice. Oh my God, you should have started writing poetry really, really long time ago. I'm so glad we spoke before NaNoWriMo and then you started writing. And I hope to see a lot more of writing from you throughout the month. Because all of these three pieces I've read before and I really want you all to go follow her and read more of her work. Also, see more of her work online since you're all locked up like all of us. So, where can we find you on the internet?
You can find me everywhere on the internet. And yes. I'm not just Bhadipa. I am more than that, guys. Come on. I write English poems. I'm not just a Marathi comic, for God's sake.
At my page.
No, it's okay. I like the love which is coming from everywhere. Nothing against anybody.
Yeah.
But yeah, there is more to me. I have been in this swimming pool for almost 22 years now. So dig and you will find me. So...
So on Instagram, you're at actor Trupti, and she also has a YouTube channel,
which is also actor everywhere. Trupti. It is just actor Trupti. Yeah.
And please go. Should I do a very nice CTA that goes like share, subscribe, comment, or just like
we let. Yes, please go for it. That's what we do. Also, go watch our Mulki Shikli Prakati Zali.
Yes, we have a lot of fun. We have uploaded 2 episodes so far. We're coming with so much more, just that we are both just too tired writing poems and being locked inside our rooms. Because I think it's more fun to do it when we're both sitting next to each other and just laughing our brains out on camera.
Yeah.
So I feel we'll get back to it really soon. And until then, thank you so much for also coming on Lit Lama. We have a very interesting conversation, which is on Golgappa, that is Trupti's podcast, which is also on the IVM network, which I feel you should check it out. And follow us both. Tell us how you found this episode, if you liked it. And I think we should all like kind of disturb Trupti over and over to give us the copy of the Ball Soprano in Marathi, Takliya.
It's an NCPA library for sure. So once the lockdown is over, you can go to NCPA library and get it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Perfect. We'll get back to it. Thank you so much, Trupti. Thanks again.
Bye. Thank you. See you.
Bye.
Welcome to Peak Planet, a new podcast where we delve into the fallouts of the growth path that we, and indeed much of the world, has chosen. Sustainable growth is the buzzword. Until we nail that down, we need to ensure that we keep our population healthy and also have the resources for our increasingly urban lifestyles. I'm Karthik Ganesan, a researcher at the Council on Energy, Environment and Water, a Delhi-based policy research institute where for almost a decade we've been trying to explain and change the use, reuse and misuse of our resources. In the first season of Peak Planet, we take up air pollution, public enemy number one, and an invisible one at that. Increasingly, the most important risk factor for adverse health outcomes, air pollution has become the most unwanted byproduct for an aggressively growing economy. Over 4 episodes, we find out how prepared our systems are to deal with this crisis. You can catch the entire first season of Peak Planet out now on the IVM Podcasts app or website, or wherever you get your podcasts from.